What's going on? This is the Hylton's Highlights podcast. I'm the host, Dakota Hylton. We are not going to have a co-host today, but we have a guest, as most podcasts do. Today we have another female, so that's awesome. We got two on here finally, so we're not sexist. And she is also a badass boxer as well, and she is from the Kansas City, Missouri area. We have Missy Fitzwater. Yeah, thanks for coming on, and sorry for messing that up. I don't know why I just blanked on your first name. So, I think it's when I talk to women in general. I think I was less nervous interviewing Butterbean, to be honest. I don't know, and we haven't filmed for a couple months, I know we were talking off camera about when you started boxing, and you said you started boxing when you were 16, and now go ahead and tell us a little bit about that, because I thought that was interesting, because who did you start training with, and then where did you start training at, and stuff like that? Yeah, speaking of that, because Craig does like some of my stuff sometimes, so if he does see this, I'm eventually going to win a fight against you guys, so we're coming back to get that. And you started training at the Firehouse, though, so how did that training look? Was it just you training with him, or did he have other people there, too? How was that going? See, that's awesome. And for a lot of people that don't know about, like, Craig, I thought it was a cool story because he's fought at Madison Square Garden and done a lot of other super cool, you know, fights and stuff. So I know that had to have been probably intimidating going in and knowing that because, I mean, just me fighting them, like, I get intimidated by that because I'm like, oh, this guy, like, these kids have to be good. He's not going to have a, you know, a crappy fighter, you know. But and did you ever take any fights with Craig? Oh, yeah, that's one thing I liked about him, because I haven't talked to him a lot, but I know I talked to him before, like, my last fight, and he's just super down to earth and super nice, and seems like he genuinely just cares about boxing, and I think that's, you know, I like seeing that, because, you know, a lot of people, you know, in gyms I've been to, like, the fitness-type gyms, like, people are there for money, and so to see someone literally, in some instances, not making a dollar, actually spending their own money in some, you know, circumstances. I really like that and appreciate that. And so, you know, did you ever watch boxing before that? Because, you know, was that just that's what got you into it? Was that? So how quick was, like, that transition to, like, pretty much not doing it to, like, where it's your whole life and that's all you're doing? Because I know, isn't your mom, she's big, like, on the Golden Gloves board and stuff like that? Okay, that makes sense. Did your, I know you said you had a sister and a brother, did they ever get into it? Did you ever get them to spar with you or no? Yeah, I'm always trying to get my brother in. I mean, he started coming and stuff, but it's also like a weird thing. You can't like force someone to want to like spar. It's a weird thing to get hit all the time. I still don't know if I like it sometimes, but I still do it. And what? How often are you going to the gym and stuff now? Are you there like 4 or 5 days a week or? And you go to KCK Powell now, right? Yeah, that's a cool facility because that's an old church and stuff. And I like, you guys are lucky too because you got that hill. Because I remember I came to get my passbook or whatever, or give you guys money to go get one or whatever, and you guys were running down that hill. And I was like, man, I wish we had this over at our gym or stairs. Do you guys run stairs ever anywhere? Yeah. I know Larry over there at Authentic. I remember I went there to spar one time before my first fight in January, and they had us run the stairs. And I thought I was in shape. And then like you're running the stairs, and you're the last one, and you're like, "Am I ready to fight?" Yeah, that and push-ups. I've gotten better at push-ups, but I don't like them. So, and you're teaching, you know, kids and stuff up there. What's your, probably your favorite part about that? Yeah, I like that because I've had instances of both of that, the humbling and the confidence, because I was always, at one point I was 300 pounds, so like I was always like self-conscious about that, and boxing helped me like, one, I became addicted, I was always like competitive, and I was always still at 300 pounds, like I could run up and down the court with kids playing basketball or whatever, just not for the longevity. So, like, when it came to boxing, I just got obsessed with it. I don't like people being better than me. And it's, like, one of those things. It's a team sport, but it's also very self-centered. And so it's, like, I don't know. I didn't. And then when someone punches you in the face, you just, like, don't want to, like, you got to, like, respond. So it just got me, like, really, you know, into that. And I've had a couple times where I was the best person in my gym. And, you know, you start thinking, like, you're untouchable. And then luckily, I went and sparred with this pro guy, and he dropped me. And, like, it was with a body shot, though. And I was like, okay, like, but that got me where I started working out a lot harder. Because you realize, like, there's levels to it. Like, you know, you see these new guys come in, and it's like, yeah, you can pretty much do whatever you want. But if you go with someone that's, you know, been sparring for 5, 6 years, like, you're not going to, like, do very well, like, half the time. And so it's just weird seeing that, like, that train. But that gives you more confidence, too, like, when you can go with those guys that are experienced and you actually land a real shot and they're not just letting you land it. So that's a long explanation of that, I guess. But Yeah. Now, have you ever had that going on the opposite side of that, though, where you're in a gym sparring with someone and they know you're the better person, and so they're trying to really bring it because it's kind of like the, you know, that thing for them. They have to try to prove it to themselves that they can do it. I know I've been on both sides of that because then sometimes you're trying to just spar that day and you're like, oh, I got to, like, actually, like, I got to move or, like, you're going to get taken out. So, but I think that's the fun part of it, though. No one would ever, like, you can get in the ring with someone and know, like, hey, like, I can just move around and, like, I'm going to be okay, or I can, like, guard up. And I think that's the one thing I've learned a lot more is, like, learning to block and, like, move. Like, you don't necessarily have to always land big shots if you can just move. So. Now, do you feel like you get into, like, these habits, though? Because this is what I feel like I do, like, I have this, like, eye-opening thing where I started moving around, and I feel like I'm Muhammad Ali for a second. I'll just, like, be doing crazy stuff. But then, like, I'll have these times where, like, I go into a whole different style, and I just think I just want to fight inside all the time and just try to walk people down. And I feel like I'm trying now to, like, get a mix of that. And because also, like, that's the thing, too. Like, sometimes if you're not having fun with it, then it's like, why are you doing it? And I think that's what I've been really trying to focus on now is, like, I'm not going to just focus on just, like, doing one thing. I'm going to go in there and just do what I know how to do and just have fun. And it's like, if something bad happens, you know, that was whatever, you know. But what's your favorite style to, like, box in? Yeah, I think that's where I have problems, too, is I start trying to think, like, you can slip this and throw this uppercut, and then it's like, I'm thinking about it, and so you're just doing it slow or whatever, and just, it's not right. And that's where, like, I was sparring actually yesterday, I guess, and I was kind of doing that thing where, like, I was just kind of messing around, just trying to have fun, and, like, I was actually, like, I don't think you should put your hands down, but I also was in a situation where, like, I knew I could move, like, I was a foot taller than the guy, like, I knew I could move, and he's not gonna, like, he's got to really try to get to me, so, like, I kind of, like, just move around and, like, throw a couple punches, and it was just working so much better because I was just so unpredictable, and, like, I do have, like, a pretty good jab or whatever, it's pretty quick, so, like, I kind of just, like, move around and then, like, come in from a different angle, and I think that's my problem I have when I'm, like, thinking about it too much is because I'm, like, oh, I gotta get this angle. And then I'm thinking about too much of what I'm doing with my feet, and I don't just do it. I'm just, like, it's just way more predictable. Yeah. Do you ever talk while you're sparring or no? Yeah, I would go through phases. Like, sometimes I do, like, that's how I'll, like, get in that phase where I start trying to do, the Tyson head move, like, that peekaboo stuff, and I'll just be, like, talking as I'm, like, just doing it, just throwing random punches, but it's normally with guys that, like, we're, like, friends, and it's, like, if I actually, you know, we're not really pissing each other off, whatever. And what do you think about harder sparring? When you're sparring, are you mainly going lighter, or do you have your, like, before your fights where you're more or less having fights while sparring? What's your opinion on that type of stuff? Yeah. Well, and I can tell a difference, too, whenever I'm not doing it, because, like, I feel like I'm more susceptible to getting, like, black eyes and stuff if, like, I'm not going hard sparring for a couple weeks. So, but I try to find that balance, too, because it does suck sometimes getting headaches, whatever, but I don't feel like it happens. I feel like I think more about it than, like, it actually, like, sometimes I feel like I if you think enough about something being there, like, you think it's there type thing. Like, so I think I do that a lot, especially when you're getting hit in the head a lot. You're like, am I messing myself up? But, I mean, I'm sure you know that. Because you said, how many fights do you have now, you said? Yeah, see, that's crazy. I'd have to, do you still get nervous when you're stepping in the ring? Oh, yeah. Yeah, I try to do that, and like sometimes I'll do good and sometimes I won't. I do, like, I have bad anxiety a lot of times, so like sometimes I'll literally be back there kind of like shaking, like, but like not like, that's where you'll see me, if you ever seen that fight, a lot of times if I was just standing there, I'd be back there like kind of shaking, kind of freaking out, but if that's where you'll see me pace around. I'll be walking around the whole place, so like people probably think I'm super nervous. I'm not even nervous about the fight. It's more of just like, once you get in there, you can't turn back. Like, that's it. And I think that's the, like, and you don't know what's going to happen. Just because I know I can beat somebody doesn't mean they're not going to knock me out. So I think that's the thing that, like, kind of, that unknown kind of terrifies me. But I do enjoy it. But it's more even, I think that's what makes me tired from a fight is more the adrenaline just building up. And, I mean, because I think that's what's so weird, too, is after a fight, I can spar 10 rounds, you know, on a weekend and feel somewhat fine, but after a fight, like, I feel like I'm dead and you only went, you know, 3 2-minute rounds, so I definitely think that adrenaline is the main reason for that, at least for me, so. Yeah, that's, it's crazy. Yeah, and yeah, I'm hoping that the more we fight, obviously the better it's just gonna get. And my hope is to go pro. Is that, I'm assuming, is that what you're wanting to do with it? Yeah, that's kind of how I've looked at it. My thing is, like, I have a super addictive personality. So, like, when I get into something, it's, like, all, like, I do or whatever. And my thing is, like, if I'm going to fight, even one fight, I'm going to try to train like I'm trying to be a champion or whatever. And I've always thought, like, growing up, I was going to be a pro athlete. So, it's, like, I feel like this is my last chance to, like, say, oh, I was a pro athlete. Even if I go in there and get knocked out in the first, like, pro fight, like, I feel like that would still be a win. Because, like, oh, you're a pro athlete, so. No. Yeah, and that's the thing. As long as you just take one or two at least, and it's like if they go good, you just keep going. Is how I look at it, and how I look at it now too is you don't necessarily have to be the best, and you don't even necessarily have to fight the best people. It's like as long as you could put on, you know, if you can put two fighters that, you know, aren't necessarily, they might not be the best as far as they might not beat this world champion or whatever, but they could put on a good fight. Those two. I don't think it should matter. Like, and that's why I really like the like Jake Paul and Logan Paul and then those guys fighting too, just because like some of that's still interesting because those matchups are kind of even. Actually, I take that back to the Logan Paul, that last fight was crap with Dylan Danis. I don't know if you watched any of that or you pay attention, but he was, like, not even throwing, like, real punches. He had, like, one, an eight or something that was, like, kind of nice. But other than that, I was like, this is embarrassing. Now, Jake Paul, I went and watched him fight. And I think he's the real deal. I think he could be, like, a legitimate boxer. Like, I think he'd be ranked if he was, you know. But obviously, he's not coming up like, you know, we are and doing all the amateur stuff or whatever. But then again, when you sell tickets, I don't think it should matter also. So it's the kind of give and take on that. Yeah, that's how I've been with it, too, because, and that's also, but with that approach, that's what I'm, and this is what I keep telling people, like, this is my whole approach, like, with the boxing stuff, is I'm going to take it as far as I can for a personal, you know, goals, like, I want to see, you know, if I can go pro or how far I can go going pro or whatever, but also from the business side of it, like, even now with, like, the amateur stuff, it's like, if my goal is to go pro, I'm trying, like, even with doing the podcast and stuff, I'm trying to get some type of fan base so that way if we go pro, we're selling 100, 200, 300 tickets and then people can't help. They have to pay you if you're selling that many tickets. So, like, that's kind of, like, my whole approach with it, too. And I feel like a lot of these guys around here, which I kind of talked to you about the other day, is, like, these guys don't know what they're, like, they're doing with, like, social. They don't do social media. And it's, like, why would this organization sign you to come fight if you're not going to sell them tickets? You're not making them money, you know. So now if you're like Tank Davis or someone like that, you might get lucky and someone picks you up. But I feel like there's some guys that have the talent that if they just, you know, if they had 10,000, 20,000, 30,000 followers, someone's going to like pick that up because they're going to sell, you know, the pay-per-views or whatever off of it. So. Yeah. Well, and then also, how many guys do you really see that have shirts when you go to these pro fights? I know at least three or four that are like the top Kansas City pros that they don't have merchandise. So how are like, and some people I guess with that are also like, well, why should I be doing that or whatever? It's like I'm big on like, the more you put out, the more people see, and then you get that, like, respect and stuff like that. And I personally would like to see, you know, like, Memorial Hall get sold out again. That's, like, and I've told this to people, and I want to be a part of, bring, like, a big, like, show back, like, to Kansas City, where it's, like, selling a place like that or, like, the Independence Event Center out. Like, I think it's possible, especially in this day and age. But it also sometimes it is gonna take a lot of money too. Thank you. it's I think the way things are going for sure, especially you have like three or four guys going to the national trials. Because I know like Ben Turla and you said Isaac, and I know there's a couple of, I know I'm missing a few, but those are the main ones that I know. But yeah, and see, that's the thing, I didn't even realize that when I first got into like the whole boxing, like I can't think of the kid's name now, he's on my Facebook. I think he goes to, who did the show Under the Bridge, Leo Moreno. He's a national qualifier that goes over there. I know his name. Yeah. So I know there's, like, when I first, like, saw that stuff, I was, like, just super excited. Because I didn't, you know, realize, like, you know, there's really some heavy hitters like that around here. It's super cool to see. And I didn't even, you know, when I first got into boxing, I didn't know who Tommy Morrison was. Like, so then whenever I discover all this stuff, and then it just motivated, like, you know, I go back, and I remember watching the video of, well, first I'll get, first we're at a Turner fight, and I remember someone saying, like, oh, that's John Brown, and I was like, oh, well, who's John Brown? And he's like, oh, he's Tommy Morrison's manager, and I went back, and I looked it up, and I looked up the Memorial Hall fight, and literally, like, it says Tommy Morrison, and it shows his corner man or coach, and it's like, John Brown, and I'm like, this is crazy, you know, because this, like, in the 80s, like, that was probably what the 90s, maybe early 2000s, that was, you know, huge, and it's something that nowadays you wouldn't even know was, like, a big part of Kansas City, but that's where, like, I like what Golden Gloves is doing. They're bringing that back, and like you said, last year I saw, you know, the production got way better, and I know you do a lot of those videos and the pictures, and I definitely really like that, and I appreciate you using my picture for this year's flyer, by the way, as well, because, like, I saw that, and I freaked out, and then, plus, also, you know, like, I just see it at other gyms and stuff, and I'm like, that's cool, so I appreciate that. Yeah, so that was from my first fight. I got lucky, because one of our friends just went there and took photos of it, and her name's Kelly. So she sees this, like, she takes amazing photos, and yeah, I need to have some more taken, though, because the way your muscles look in those photos, that's what I like. Yeah. Well, that one under the bridge that Leo did, that was a super cool experience. I don't know if you were there. That was, like, for one, I was wearing, it was like a Mexican event, and I'm wearing American flag trunks. So, like, everyone that came by was, like, talking to us, and, like, I was on, like, a bunch of people's, like, stories and stuff, and, like, even Mayor Quentin Lucas had, like, shared a video on his Facebook of, like, my fight and stuff, so I thought that was, like, super cool. Yeah, and then someone took photos of that, though, and, like, it's just, the way those photos look, it's, like, it does not look like that in real life, I don't feel like, but whatever they're doing, yeah. Yeah. See, and that's what I want to see more of, and, like, that's kind of, like, what I'm wanting to, like, get into the whole promotion side of things and, like, try to figure that out to make things more of a show. Also, you're not having 20, like, this is the thing, no one wants to sit at a boxing event for 6 hours. Like, I love boxing, but after about 2 hours, like, I can't even feel my butt because, like, the seats are terrible, you know. So that's why I want to get into the whole, like, production of it and just making it where, like, some of these kids that'll never go pro, like, where they could have that experience of, like, feeling like they're, like, a superstar. So yeah, and also, like, some more, like, with the amateur boxing, which I think there's ways around it, which I want to look into, is, like, because obviously as an amateur boxer, you can't make money, which I don't understand that, because, like, I know amateur MMA, like, they can make money off of ticket sales, which I think would, in turn, like, make amateur boxing even bigger if they did that, because people would be more willing to hustle tickets and stuff like that, but I want to look into, like, maybe is there a way around that to where you can, like, give back to the boxing clubs that are bringing the fighters. So whether it's like giving equipment out or whatever, and I feel like you guys did that. Didn't you guys do that with punching bags or something? Yeah, see, I like, you know, stuff like that. I think there's a lot of room to, like, just keep growing it and making things better. And I think that's what I like about the boxing community. Is everyone's so cool, too. Like, you know, Donovan over at Flacco, like, every time I see him, he's always, like, comes up and says something to me. And it's, like, all these people you've just met through, like, other events, and they're willing to help you. Like, I know I've talked about wanting to do the events, and, you know, guys are willing to let me, like, come and help with their events so I can learn it. And so I think that's, again, what's so cool about it's the community behind it. I think it's just going to keep growing from here, so. Yeah. Well, yeah, and that's the thing, too, like getting these other gyms to get together and support, whether it's their shows or spar together. I mean, because even as far as, like, the pros go, it's like 9 times out of 10, you're not going to fight any of these guys. You can pick and choose who you want to fight, you know, so... Like, you wouldn't have to unless, obviously, you're, like, fighting for a title of some sort. So, it's, like, it doesn't make sense why these guys aren't, like, getting together. And I think the problem becomes a lot of coaches, some of these guys are greedy and they want to, like, take people from people. And I've seen that, people being taken from our gym or whatever. And, you know, it's a part of it. But I think that's where, like, the issue becomes is, like, these guys don't want to, like, put all their time into someone and then they, like, jump ship just because, like, this guy's telling them they're going to give them something better, which I've definitely seen that or whatever, but. Yeah. Yeah, see, now I respect it when it's done like that. Because, like, I will say that's, you know, Liberty doesn't train at the gym that I'm at anymore or whatever. But, like, that coach, like, literally, like, Nick, he literally told, you know, made a comment to me. He's like, you know, basically, like, yeah, it sucks, but, like, why would he care? Like, it's less drive for her to go to where she's going now. You know, and she's getting good work and she can spar more with more females. So it's like, why would I be mad about her leaving, you know? And that was a situation, but I've seen situations over, like, teams go sparring at another gym, and, like, the coach literally comes up and be like, oh, I'll give you some free equipment, and I'll pay for all your traveling and stuff like that. And I kind of, like, you know, looked the other way at that. But, I mean, then again, people's got to – you got to do what's best for you. So, at the same time, it's like, I get it, I guess. Yeah. Yeah, and that's the thing. If everyone just works together, everyone, you know, gets better, and And that's, even on that part, that's why I want to shout out Nick, though, because that's one thing with Nick. I was going to his gym and sparring, and honestly, the first time I sparred at his gym, I literally went back and told my coach, I was like, man, he's kind of a dick. Like, he wouldn't even, didn't really talk to me like that. Like, he was nice, but, like, he wasn't trying to, like, give me a bunch of advice or whatever, because he didn't want to come off like he was trying to steal me. But then we kind of built this friendship. But even, like, you know, I'd go in there kind of talking crap to him or whatever, and he'd never try to take me. Like, he never, like, tried to take me or anything. It ended up coming to me, like, just saying, like, I'm not getting what I need over here, like, you know, do you think we could do something? And you know, it worked out. And I think that's, like you said, it's kind of needed in some aspects, because you also can't be the best person at your gym, like, all the time. Because if you're the best person at your gym, I feel like that's, I don't know, it's a tough spot to be in, because then you don't have anything to, like, shoot for to get better. So. So I know we've been talking about boxing a lot here, so let's get off of boxing for a little bit here. So besides boxing, you know, what kind of stuff are you into on the day-to-day? Is there anything, you into nature trails, gamer or something? What do you do? I like going to the nature trails around here and stuff, too. Those are fun. But I do want to go to Colorado and stuff like that. But then you're spending so much money. But there's one of my friends, he used to tell me there's, like, a trail out there. I think it takes, like, a month to do. Like, if you walk it or you bike it or whatever, and, like, you stay along the way. I feel like something like that would be really cool, too. But I also have to be in a position where you can take a month off of work. So it's... Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. That's what, like, I think it would have been so fun to be, like, in the Lewis and Clark days, like, actually exploring like that. But I'm also, like, terrified of snakes and spiders, so I don't know if it would have been a very fun time. Like, it could have went either way, I guess. Yeah. I still don't get how people keep them as pets. We have a friend that's actually caught, it was a speckled black king snake. He literally, he cuts grass, and it was, like, went out of this, like, brush area, and he literally just caught it, and it's, like, his pet snake now. He's, like, he actually said he forcefully kind of grabbed the snake, because you don't know if it's going to try to bite you, and he actually said, like, the snake was kind of like, what are you doing? Like, wasn't freaking out or anything, and, like, within that couple of days, like, the dude's, like, slithering in his pocket and stuff, and it's like, no. Yeah. Yeah, no. I'm not about that life. I gotta, like, throw stuff at spiders. Like, they're in the shower, I'm, like, getting a cup of water, and, like, trying to throw them down. Yeah. Especially when you, because if you see the hairy ones, dude, sometimes those things jump so far, and it's like, I'm not about that. Yeah. Yeah. Just bugs in general. So, do you guys have four-wheelers and stuff? Yeah, my mom lives on a farm, actually. They have, like, 20 acres or something like that. And so, yeah, she has a bunch of animals and stuff. But they don't have four-wheelers either, so that's why I don't go down that much. So if she gets some four-wheelers, I'll come down there more. So hopefully she'll listen to this. She listens to a lot of stuff I do, so hopefully, yeah. Get a four-wheeler, yeah. Instead, she bought a shed. It's actually a nice shed, though. Yeah. Have you ever thought about, like, I'd love to get those sheds and actually live in them. Like, but it's also, like, a weird thing. I don't need a ton of room. But it's like, if I just had the land, I would do it for like a short period of time because you could do it so cheaply. But. Yeah. Yeah, she has this one, like, so it's like a repoed one, which is like, that tells you, like, what kind of people we are. We buy repoed sheds. But it was still like, it's still like $7,000 or whatever, but it's like a nice one. It, like, it has the little front porch thing. You walk in, there's two sides. And it's like, it's just kind of crazy because it's like, well, I could literally put a bed over here and have a desk over here. And I, like, would be perfectly content. But then you have to, like, it's getting the land. That's the problem these days. It's hard to buy, like land's expensive, or it's, like, hard to find just, like, an acre where they'd let you build that because, like, cities have all their ordinances and whatever. Yeah. Yeah. So what's been your favorite animal you guys have owned? Oh, they're so annoying though too. And the poop there, the goat poop is the worst. Oh yeah. Yeah, so we were living like in Arkansas one time. We were like living on the road, it's a whole story. But we were like we were working on the carnival stuff, whatever, and this is when I was like 16. And I might have been 15. Anyways, we're staying in the back of this gas station, and me and my brother are sleeping in my mom's Tahoe. And we had randomly, on the way to this place we're at, my mom found a goat on the side of the road, and it was blind. And, like, my mom has a thing for, like, animals, and let alone animals that are hurt. So it's like, it's a double whammy blind goat. So the thing, like, it couldn't see anything, so she's like, constantly doing whatever goats do. I can't think of the goat sound or whatever, but I don't know. He had to sleep in the he slept in the car with us for like 2 days, and yeah, it was a wild experience. Think about sleeping. You know goats. So just think about the goat buying or whatever it does in the back seat as you're trying to sleep. No, it was a. I hate telling people those stories because it's like. It's a crazy story, but it's so funny to me. Some of that stuff was like a normal person's like, what the hell? And we, at one point, we had pigs in our house, too. That was a whole thing, so. So we bought two potbelly pigs, but they got big. Like, they got huge. And we lived, like, down these stairs. So there's, like, it became a point where we had to, like, it was hard for them to get down the stairs. We had to eventually, like, put them in the garage and stuff. Because we lived in a small town. There's, like, 500 people. But we lived in downtown buildings. So, like, we were, like, kind of those people. Yeah, we went through the rabbit phase. We had a bunch of rabbits because my mom was going to sell rabbits. You know, and that's the thing. My mom's like me because I have like this hustler mindset, but she does it with weird things like animals. So, and then like, but she's also good. She loves the animals and stuff. We always had dogs and cats, rabbits, guinea pigs. We had everything, but. Yeah, that would be my mom. I mean, she always said she bought cows so we could have you know, meat and stuff, and those cows are still in her like pasture, so yeah, she can't. She always says she could get them to kill them, and she can't. But which is like weird because her husband, like, they're hunters and stuff, so like, you know, but not her animals. They're not gonna kill her animals. I want to go hunting and stuff though, but I don't know if I could kill deer. Like, I know I could, but I have like this weird like thing in my head. I feel like I would subconsciously be like, feel so bad about killing a deer. Yeah, but if someone else kills them, I'll eat them for sure, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good, because those vegans are weird. Sorry if you're vegan. No, that's fair. I don't have anything against vegans. My brother's last girlfriend she was vegetarian or whatever. So, like, we went through that phase where, like, I wasn't eating meat for a long time. And not because I would, but, like, not whenever, like, we're eating stuff together and stuff. So, I couldn't do it. I love chicken a lot. Chicken is, like, my favorite thing. I feel like that's, like, all I eat. But, so, Eddie, what time are we at? I don't know. We're probably getting close to the hour, probably, right? What time are we at? Oh. We're at 41? 48. All right. Well, we'll just do a couple things. We'll have you edit this part out. Do you have anything coming up here that you want to talk about? I know you said you're probably going to try to fight in January or something like that. Yeah, I need to start getting in and doing more. And how often do you run and stuff like that? I know we kind of talked about it, but so when you're like training for a fight, then it's every day. Like how much are you doing every day? Yeah, that makes sense. I need to definitely step it up a little bit. And my running, though, it's kind of always been there. Like, once I got to a certain point, someone got me into running, and I just started running, like, all the time. It started with, like, a mile a day, and then two, and then three, and then I was doing 5 miles 5 days a week for a while. And, like, I don't necessarily have knee problems, but, like, everything makes noises and stuff. So, it's like, there's going to be problems eventually. So, I kind of, like, toned it down a little bit, but I still, if I don't run, like, 3 miles a day, it's kind of, like, I feel kind of, it's weird, I start feeling fat and stuff, and it's, like, a terrible feeling. I don't. Yeah, that's how I've gotten, too, which is, it's so weird to think about, too, at a certain point where, like, I wouldn't do anything at all, and it's, like, now it's like literally to the point like I just feel sick if I don't do something. And how many days are you going a week? Are you doing 5-6 days a week, or are you doing? Yeah, that tends to be what I do. And I sometimes I'll go 7 days, like if like I feel like I just need to go run like a mile or two or something. I feel like it never. It's not gonna hurt you to like do something, but I don't know. The running sucks. It's like every time you do it, it sucks. It's like no matter what, it's like no matter how much you do it, it sucks. Yeah, no, the only reason I do, like, get into it sometimes is, like, I'd go run at the plaza and run into the rich houses, and I start, like, I daydream a lot, so, like, I'll be, like, running, thinking about living in this house, and it's, yeah. But, yeah, you have to do that. If you're just doing it down there where you live, like, it's not going to be a good time. Yeah. I need to start doing it more, though. I would just go and run random places. It actually would be fun to just do something like going to different small towns and run every small town, because you could literally, when you're running someplace, you see a lot more than you, like, realize than you would, like, if you're just driving by. Like, the stuff people have in their yards and just, you know, cars, stuff someone might have in their window, just, I don't know, stuff like that is just, that's what keeps me running. Yeah, you kind of think you know people even though you don't know them. It's kind of hard, like, if you go, like, in Blue Springs or somewhere, like, these nicer areas and do it, it's not as fun. You gotta go, like, a trashy area, so that way it's like, oh, these people have, like, 4 bikes in their yard or something, like, they probably have kids. You know, but, yeah, but, well, anyways, I know we're getting close to that time, so we can go ahead and wrap this up and stuff. I appreciate you for coming on, and, you know, anyone out there, definitely look her up. Where can they find you at if they're... Yeah, and, you know, with that, too, if you post, you know, pictures of you fighting and stuff, if you add her, she will edit a lot of those. So, you know, take advantage of that free work, because I'm always sharing them because I don't like to have to go and edit my own stuff. So, but thanks for coming on, and hopefully we'll see you fighting soon. Well, you guys have a great day, and thanks for watching.